Welcome to a new test and teardown video. We are still playing around with homebrew stuff. Look at this one. Vhf Transverter. So a transverter is like a transmitter receiver, but it is built as a front end, most likely for a HF radio. So this will got this will have like all the VHF stuff, but not audio things like that, modulation, demodulation, and things like that. That is the normal way the transverters work. I hope we will be able to see if this is also the case in this one. It looks a little bit like it is very, very old when it comes to the design here, because what we see is the normal standby and operate and stuff, and the meter that can measure, you know, voltages and currents and powers and automatic level control, stuff like that. And this is normally on very old tube equipment, so I think this is interesting to see if there's no tubes in this one, I guess. So this will be transistors. I think this one was built between 1970 and 1980. At that period of time, VHF transmitters and receivers was like very expensive. So you were most likely built your own because you already had HF radios. And here is the rear side. It looks like there is a coax relay, antenna relay, and external power amplifier relay. And that is most likely RF to the HF radio. This looks like the microphone input, but that is a little bit weird because why are you doing that when microphone signals, or, you know, like modulation, the RF signal from your HF transmitter will probably go in here, right? And then just be amplified and mixed and stuff. And this is, of course, your VHF antenna. I guess this is a power supply, maybe a diode. So let's open and have a look. No surprise, this unit is indeed very beautifully made. Proper cable holder, main switch is turning off everything, even two mains relay fuses. Oh, but why is one of them connected like this? That is a little bit funny, isn't it? And here's the 2x19 volts, and then a big fat rectifier. So this is probably a 12 or 14 volts high power supply, and an auxiliary supply for lower power. Yeah, we need to open everything here and see what is in this box. So now we are inside, and this is the bottom, and I took off the shield those around the power amplifier. I think this is a power output detector. It isn't really an SVR bridge or anything. It's only measuring the voltage output. We got some rectifier diodes and some biasing for the diodes. So that means it will be able to detect quite low output powers. And then there's a low pass filter. I added some text, so it's easier to figure out everything. So this is, of course, the final stage power amplifier and the pre-driver. And the biasing is done a very classic way with diodes. And then they're biasing the diode. And this is also the voltage for the base. And over here, we got some two diodes in parallel and a lot more power, so that the base point is fed is fed with a much lower impedance. And then it goes on to a pre-buffer stage, and then it goes to the other side of this transverter. Let's look a little bit at the power supplies. This power supply is a very conventional design. We got a 4 diodes, so it's a bridge, capacitor, and just a 7812, and it's generating about 12 volts all the time. And this is used for all auxiliary circuits and RX. So there is also a 14.9 volt power supply that is actually always on, the way it is here. This power supply is made in a very special way. Let's look at that. So the center point of the transformer, center point goes to positive of the capacitors, and the positive side here is directly output positive. The two sides of the transformer goes to only half of this bridge. So he's only using the negative side of the bridge. See, the red one is marked with red permanent marker, but there's nothing on that one. So this is the negative, and that goes to the negative side of the capacitor. So here's 12 volt negative. So that one goes on the black wire to the emitter of an NPN transistor, and the collector is 0 volts. So that is just chassis. And then we got this regulation system. So this power supply is regulating in the negative. There isn't really anything wrong in doing it this way. Jostykit invented this in the 70s with a power supply called NT400. And the fun thing is, if you see here, Jostykit. So that means this power supply is from a Jostykit power supply set. And also those cases and a lot of components you see here is also from a store in Denmark called Brink Elektronik, and they also sell Jostykit. So I think my good friend who made this unit back in the 70s, he was inspired by the NT400 design, because that is exactly how this one is done. There is no op amp, because we don't really need an op amp, because it's not variable or anything. It's just a signal diode and a compare system and a pre-driver, and then the NPN transistor. That's kind of all there is to say about this power supply. I still haven't figured out exactly what is the point with this red wire that is in front of the fuses, but I think it is quite funny. There's probably some smart detail about that. Let's look at the other side. Oh yeah, before we look at the other side, I want you to see this. Let's just do a clear right and a max hold. I'm actually performing a sweep on the input from 144 to 146 megahertz. So, and this marker here is 29, and this sweep is 27 to 31. So that means this is the entire 10 meter band with 29 megahertz here. We actually go over, I think so, right? So it's 29 megahertz plus minus one. So you either need to only use the lower side of the 2 meter band, or you need to have like a 10 meter radio that is open to go a little bit higher if you want to use the entire 2 meter band. That is just the way this transverter is made. But also, if we look at the curve, it looks a lot like it is almost flat from 145 and down to 144. And this will be about here in this area where the SSB area is normally. So that means maybe this transverter is made for SSB operation because of the curve. But that also means this transverter is working, at least it is working in receive mode. I of course try to play with the standby, operate and lock. Lock means it's locked in transmit mode. Also what I can say about the transmit mode is the 15 volts here goes to all the power stages as well, but then there is a 12 volt, that is the 12 volt TX kind of signal that goes to the biasing. So transistors here, they're actually always supplied with the high power 15 volts, but bias is coming and when you are in transmit mode, and that will activate the power off course. So that's kind of how it works, and this is a good way to switch only much less currents. And this is the bottom side. There's a shielded case just like the other one, and it's quite easy just to take off this shield. So let's have a look. The TX signal from the low pass filter is coming here. So there's a relay, an RXTX relay, and look, this relay is actually mounted in an isolated way. You can even move it a little bit, see? So I don't understand exactly why that is cool, but there's definitely something to it with when it comes to the ground or the signal path of the input and output, probably. And then this is the RX. So this is a pre-amplifier, like an LNA. Again with some filters, and yeah, one more, and this is I guess controlled. No, there's no level control or anything, because look at this. This is the 12 volt RX, and it's just connected to everything. So that's just how it is. And then the 145 megahertz go through another Storno filter. So yes, like I said before, he did work for Storno. I see a lot of Storno parts here as well, by the way, but you could probably also see this if you poked around in Storno equipment. So this is the transverter itself. There is a fixed oscillator and it is running at 58 megahertz. However, this is just the fundamental of the crystal. It is, I think this is running in, maybe the first state here is running at 58, but the two next stages, they're definitely running at 116 megahertz. And the 116 goes into the mixer. I don't know if you can see the pins, but this pins is probably one of those SPL mixers or any other of those standard 8-pin mixers. And this is the input or the output pin you have here in the middle. And here we go. This is the transmit path. And then there's the transmit filter. And then it goes to the other side for all the transmitter stuff. So the antenna signal comes in here. That one. So there's actually a diode switch. You can see the two diodes here in series, and then it goes to the mixer. And there's also, when you transmit or receive, then you got this one, the white and gray, or I mean red and gray, or the other red and white. That is transmit or receive 12 volt, and the red always, or the full red is always 12 volt. So that is how this system is switched between RX and TX. And those two voltages, they also go around to all the diodes to activate the TX or the RX path to and from the mixer. So in RX mode, 29 megahertz is coming out, because 145 minus 116 is 29. And then 29 megahertz goes to a little amplifier and a filter. So that is more or less how this thing works. I haven't yet figured out exactly about this microphone connector. I think this is probably just in parallel with the microphone connector to the transmitter, to the transmitter or the transceiver. That is, of course, a 29 megahertz transceiver. So this needs to kind of listen or be in parallel with this, so it can switch between RX and TX. And then that will be some circuits handling this. It's probably some delays also to handle an external power amplifier or an external LNA, because that is what was written on the rear side. Yes, transmit also worked. I did exactly the same. I input 28 to 30 megahertz sweep, and then I just look at the output. I've now calibrated the analyzer, so I can measure dBm all the way around here. So this is the entire 2 meter band, and our 145 is in the middle. So let's take the marker and let's go down in the good area here. So that is 43 dBm where it maxes out, and that is 20 watts. So this transverter can do 20 watts, and it actually works. Isn't that fantastic? But at 20 watts output. Okay, let's go back to the trace and let's clear this right. So let's turn on the transmitter. And this is a full power. Look at the input power. And now we're going in the lower end of the power. Now it's restarting in a second. Look at that. 125 watts. That is a lot of input and only 20 watt output, so that is 100 watts. Of course, you don't want to do this for a long time. You're going to overheat the transistors. So definitely this is SSB, or perhaps you're not supposed to give it that much power. Let's go a little bit down here and see how that goes. See, we have a usage of 11 watts in receive, and now we go transmit. Oh yeah, that is also quite a lot. Ooh, yeah. I think we should go down to 10 watts. Then it's only 76 watts. Okay, yeah. Well, the efficiency isn't, of course, that high, and this is, of course, because the power supply voltage is quite high. But anyway, it's really working. Ooh, the power supply transistor is getting warm. That is nice. I can still touch it, but yeah, I think also you can see the power, the output power is going up and down with the frequency. So that is definitely also working. So that was really a beautiful unit, and it really looks like everything here is fully homemade and home designed in the start of 1970, something about that. I've been looking at different transistors, and I saw a few evidences on the other side that was in the start of the 1970s, 1980s, in that area. Of course, you can use older components a little bit later, but